Hi, I'm Nic Gorman. I am the writer and the director of Human Traces. Okay, so the film's set on a sub-Antarctic island, which is a little body of islands that basically lie in between New Zealand and Antarctica at the bottom of the world. There's a husband and wife scientist team. Their job there is to get rid of all the pests on the island. And a stranger arrives, someone they haven't known before, and that's kind of where the story begins. I think as a storyteller, the setting, the island, was the first thing that I came to, before the characters, before the structure, before the plot. And I was just fascinated by these places, these islands which I sort of researched and I read a lot about, these, because of their kind of unique character. They're amazing kind of individual ecosystems, but they're also places that have actively kind of resisted any kind of sense of humans trying to control them or settle them or kind of do stuff. They had whalers there for a bit, and the settlement was started, but it failed because just the weather was too inhospitable. There's been all these shipwrecks here, all these shipwrecks there. So I thought it was kind of an interesting place to set characters and put characters on. And everything else in the film grew out of the location, the character archetypes, the structure, the plot, all kind of came from this place, which, you know, it's almost a cliche to say, but the island is its own character. The location is as important in the film as any of the characters, because the characters in this film are defined by their relationship to the land, the place they're on. So in terms of the production, we'd looked a long time to find the right place. The challenge was finding somewhere that did feel isolated, that did feel like the end of the world. So we'd find these amazing, beautiful beaches, but there was too many kind of introduced trees, or there was like a farm in the background, or there was, you know, some power lines that you could see, and we weren't going to be able to get the coverage for it. So we sort of walked, and we sort of basically ended up filming at the southernmost point of New Zealand, apart from all the islands that sort of lie at the bottom, but it was pretty much as far south as you can go in New Zealand, and by extension as far south you can go in the world. So, you know, we had to kind of drive like half an hour from the closest town over a dirt road, and then we had to leave our cars, and we had to get four-wheel drives to run us up and down from the place. So it was incredibly challenging, but it was also... what made the shoot incredibly special was we were so bonded to this place, because it was so hard to get to, so inhospitable, but it did really kind of make us, it informed us as kind of creatives, as crew, in the same way that the landscape informs the characters in the film. Decision to kind of come up with this sort of the triptych structure, I think came, like I was saying before, like it came out of this notion of place. So these characters are geographically isolated, and that isolation makes them kind of psychologically isolated from everybody else as well. And I kind of started thinking about perspective and isolation, and how kind of being in a place like that does strange things to you. And it kind of, that felt quite organic, that progression into the actual structure, where we just spend time with each of these characters, and we really wanted to dig into their heads. So the way it was written, the way it was shot, it's very kind of a close subjective experience, in that you're kind of in walking in these characters' shoes. So to then kind of tell the story using the three of them, it was a kind of a really useful way into the story for me. Yeah, you're so right. Especially with low budget stuff, you kind of need to be able to kind of work together and have kind of like-minded souls. And the three performers, the three lead actors, kind of embrace the ethos behind the film, and that they kind of, you know, it was a low budget film. We knew we were going right down south. We knew the weather was going to be hard, but in a way, kind of, I think it was really kind of inspirational for the crew to see the way that the actors just embraced the conditions, and like, you know, they were always the ones who are saying, let's do another take, let's kind of get the shot done, I don't mind getting in the water, I don't mind standing there, like, you know, there was a real kind of braveness and energy to their performances, which I think kind of inspired us all. And I think, you know, it's one of the most wonderful things as a writer, is being able to give your characters away because you spend so much time with them when they're on the page, when you look on the computer screen. And these people come in, and like I remember sort of when like Vinnie came in for his audition for the character of Ricky, like he informed me what I had been trying to write but hadn't quite got there. And like when Vinnie came in, you know, he made the character more alive than I could possibly have imagined. So it's kind of, yeah, it's one of those wonderful pleasures. Well, it wasn't shot we tried to do it as linear as we could, but, you know, just in terms of kind of locations, we needed to, you know, not do it. And we kind of had a thing that when we were shooting, it was either this is Glenn's shot or this is Sarah's shot or this is Ricky's shot. And in the edit, it didn't necessarily translate in that way. We kind of pulled scenes from other people's story to put them in. But actually in the shoot itself, it was a really kind of useful... a useful way of kind of recalibrating ourselves. You know, if we said we'd shoot a scene from Glenn's perspective and we kind of said, okay, that's it. And now we're going to do it from Sarah's perspective as well. So we kind of, while we weren't actively kind of re-blocking or changing too much, it was just kind of like just a mental shift that we all kind of took as a crew to like kind of think about whose story it was, where we needed to be at that time. It's one of the hardest things to kind of work out, I think, the notion of ambiguity. And it's such a balance, you know, and I think kind of, you know, the great films use it so well because if you, as an audience member, the worst thing to do or to have done to you is to be kind of talked at, or if the director's didactic or something, I think it can be a real sort of turn-off. But, you know, on the other side, if people aren't clear, that then they find it frustrating. And I think we did test screenings, and we're always kind of like kind of aware of that line that we kind of needed to walk down. And it was just kind of, you know, I'd send the links out to friends, and we'd have little kind of mini test screens, we'd have bigger test screenings, and it was just kind of making sure that at any point we weren't alienating the audience, but still kind of retaining that sense of mystery. You just want them to feel something, like either moved or scared or angry. I think kind of getting a reaction out of an audience. I think the kind of the screenings in Tiff have been so good because we've had great Q&As, and I think it's a really good indicator of how people are engaging with the film. And then when we leave the cinema, the conversation kind of continues and we're sort of talking to people out in the foyer and stuff. And I think, you know, having that sort of level of audience engagement is exactly what you want as a filmmaker.
Hi, I'm Mark Mitchinson and I play Glenn in Human Traces. Well, it's just always amazing to play characters that are outside your comfort zone, really. And Glenn being a scientist and somebody who lives on an island isolated from everywhere and everyone, that was very exciting to kind of grasp and to really have a go at looking at in terms of character development. So that was really the initial reason why I chose it. Well, I'd never met Vinnie before. I'd known Sophie for quite a while, and we'd always wanted to work together. So that was a lovely kind of realization of that dream, as it were. And but working with Vinnie was just a joy. You know, he's such a giving and generous actor, and in some ways, because New Zealand's so small and there are so few of us, working in such an intense environment and working just the three of us was almost like being in a play. You know, there's a element to this script, I think, that allows each of the characters to have quite a little bit of time to develop and talk through their development with each other. So that was a great opportunity for me. It's kind of crazy because where actually we were filming really does feel like it actually really is almost the where land stops, and there's just this vast ocean until you get to Antarctica. And I remember one day Nic and I were standing on the beach just looking out, and these huge waves came in, and we were both saying, you know, this is the wave that started down in the Southern Ocean, hundreds and hundreds of miles away, and it finally hits land here the first time. And that's really when it began to sink in, is that, you know, this expanse, this huge expanse of water. We had no idea how the cut was going to be. So literally we had the script that was cut back and forth from the character's perspective, but we didn't know how that final cut was going to look. So I, as one of my things that I do to get my character, I walked up this mountain, because Glenn was always walking everywhere and doing all this kind of, you know. I walked up this mountain with the script, and it took me about 9 hours, I completely misjudged it, but it was this breaking down of the script and working out how to actually work this character through, knowing that there were going to be all these jump moments. Even though we didn't know that the final cut was going to look as it did, we still had to work our way through the myriad of emotional kind of the myriad of an emotional journey of this character. So it was very, it was quite an intense experience. And certainly a very intense experience walking up a mountain for 9 hours and scripts blowing all over the place and trying to work out the journey of where Glenn really was. I think it's almost a cliche to say, but he is an actor's director. And what I mean by that is that he really senses who you are as a person and what he wants to draw out of you as the character. And that was just a lovely experience. That was just a great, you know, quite often directors often don't speak. You know, they often actually just like what you've done and then carry on. But Nick's very, his attention to the emotional detail was the thing that I loved the most. What's lovely about it and what's lovely about the feeling that I get from it is that it's about complex human emotions and what's under the surface. And one of the things I've looked at when the audience have come out is the sense of nobody's quite sure who's right and who's wrong. And you know, and initially you start off feeling quite sorry for Sophie and Sophie's character. But then you realize that Glenn has this, all the reasons why he is the way he is come out in his story. And I think that's just I think audiences relate to that and like being challenged by character movement, as opposed to just simply going, oh, I know exactly where the character is going to go in the beginning. And the arc of the character, each character they follow. And I think that's hopefully what I think they'll get from it. Well, I think it's just great. You know, I mean, it's just fabulous that we can be part of that, and also have a film that holds its own within an environment where there are, you know, big movies and big stars. And I think the thing for the New Zealand film industry is that we're actually very good at what we do, and there's a great deal of talent down there, and. And sometimes that just happens to all come together in a film like Human Traces. And actually, I think what people have been surprised about is that although it's low budget, it's actually a really terrific film.
Hi, my name is Vinnie Bennett, and I played Ricky in Human Traces. When I first got the script, I actually kind of challenged myself not to read it. I was kind of trying to take on board this mindset that if you can just kind of focus on the scene and not force the entire film into the one scene, you know, to risk giving too much. But it was the night before the audition, and I had the script there, and I thought I'd read maybe the first few pages. And I mean, fast forward 2 hours later, and I had finished it all, and I wanted it. I really wanted it after that, because it was a film that I would want to watch, and it's pretty rare for that to come along, especially in New Zealand. You know, we're pretty small, and so for something that really appeals to me artistically and creatively. It was an opportunity that I couldn't refuse, really, and it just made me really want it a whole lot more. And thankfully, I ended up landing the role in the end. I mean, the conditions down there in the Catlins, they were harsh. They were really harsh. I think it was just coming into summer, so it wasn't too bad, but it was still very, very cold. And I mean, in that part of New Zealand, it's remote, and it really belongs to the wildlife there. There's, you know, the human beings are the minority species, and so that really helped kind of get into the whole idea of being alone on this island. It really helped to break down the script day by day and think about whose perspective this is mostly on for each of the scenes, even though they were the same scene but for different characters. It was good to be aware whose perspective it was, because, you know, there's lots of POVs, you know, close-ups, etc. But it was easier than I thought. I definitely thought it would have been a pretty hard job to do. But Nick worked really well in, you know, keeping us up to date with what was going on that day. And yeah, it wasn't as hard as I thought. Yeah. I was really blessed to be able to work with, you know, such veterans, really, of New Zealand film. Mark Mitchinson, you know, he's the Don back home. He's the man. And Sophie Henderson as well. I had worked with her in my first film, actually, playing a small role in her feature film called Fantail back in 2013, I believe. And so, yeah, I felt really honoured to be, you know, in the presence. There's only three cast members, and, I mean, the other two minor cast members, Milo Cawthorn and Sarah Wiseman. Both of them are really established performers, and I was kind of the young buck and kind of just rocked in there, and I had, you know, the most lines of the whole film. So I felt a lot of pressure, but they were all really supportive, and they helped me get to where I needed to be at the end of the day. Nick is, without a doubt, an actor's director. He entrusts his performers a lot, arguably too much for some. For me, it was perfect. You know, he, obviously you feel the pressure with being entrusted with so much. He was very, very hands-off, and there's kind of this uncertainty about him, about just a lot of his direction, and I think that kind of added to the whole beauty of the film, that he didn't want it a certain way. He was willing to let us really play with the characters, and if there was something that we didn't quite feel, he was totally open to any kind of changes, any edits, and it really worked, I think, as a collaborative process between the actors and the director. I think the audience will make them think about just the minor things, and it's really easy to, you know, be caught up in your own mind, and the world can seem a certain way, but you never really consider how things might look from a different perspective, a different angle. And so hopefully the audience will be able to consider other perspectives in the smallest or biggest of situations. It's amazing. It's truly amazing. New Zealand's a small place, and it's been 2 years since we kind of finished shooting. And kind of between now and then, it's kind of just been, you know, okay, that's been done. And it's kind of like, okay, now what? Maybe friends and family back home will get to see it, maybe it will get to show in New Zealand and maybe Auckland if we're lucky. But to find out we had been accepted to Toronto Festival, I didn't really know what that would actually mean, because I'd never come to the festival before. I knew that it was massive, And to be also a part of the Rising Stars program this year, as well as have Human Traces, I was kind of just thrown right in the deep end. And it's been such a wild ride. There's so many creatives and industry professionals that are all in Toronto at the same time. And I mean, there's definitely some that have seen the film, and I mean, I've had good feedback, and it's all, it's crazy to see that the North American audience, and you know, people from around the world, I guess, that are here actually enjoy it. And there's things that aren't exclusively, you know, Kiwi, things that can translate to international audiences. Yeah, it's been amazing. The Rising Stars program is a platform for the festival to celebrate emerging Canadian and international artists. For the first time this year, they took on four internationals, me being the New Zealand representative. And essentially, it's just a very, very intense 5 days of meeting producers, filmmakers, casting directors, and having really open and honest conversations with them. I mean, for me, it really helped. It helped with seeing them as actual people, and not these kind of big, scary, intimidating casting directors or, you know, professionals. But you really got to see the person in it, and it really helped just with my overall confidence, I guess, as a performer. But I think it was an amazing program, and I'd love to recommend it to any other performer, because I think it's a great thing.